Hello students, so we will continue with the same chapter, that is why do we fall ill, and today I'll finish this chapter. Please open page number 184. Okay, before starting with this topic of principles of prevention, I would like to tell you students, this portion that is given on page 183, that is organ specific and tissue specific manifestation that is there in the syllabus. So by mistake I wrote in bracket excluded. Okay, so this whole portion is there in the syllabus. I have already explained it in the video. Okay, all page number 183 184, that is principles of treatment, this is also explained to you. Principles of prevention, this all is there. So whatever is explained to you in the video, that everything is there in the syllabus. And so it's given there manifestations, okay, in the syllabus. So actually it is organ specific and tissue specific manifestations. So please prepare well for your exam, and I have discussed all these things with you in detail. Now today please open page 184, principles of treatment. We have done principles of prevention. Now students, we have talked about so far how to get rid of infectious disease, the treatment we have discussed, but actually there are three limitations of this approach to dealing with the infectious disease. The first is that once if anyone gets disease, the body functioning is damaged. Maybe the person may not recover completely. Then if a person recovers also completely by some of the infectious disease, then the treatment will take time, and till then the person who is suffering from the disease is likely to be bedridden. Okay, and the third one is this: the person who is suffering from an infectious disease can serve as a source of disease from where the infection may spread to other people, and this leads to multiplication of the above difficulties. So these three are the limitations. Okay, so now then, that is why we say it's always prevention is always better than cure. Okay, now how the disease can be prevented? Now there are airborne diseases. The airborne diseases where the microbe, the harmful microbe or the disease causing microbe or the pathogen is in the air. So when we inhale the air, the pathogen, it goes inside the body. So now if the place is crowded, definitely there are more chances of getting infected by an airborne disease. So generally we should not go in those places which is overcrowded. Okay, then another one is waterborne microbes. Now there are certain disease which is caused due to contaminated water. If we take that water, okay, so the water should be clean, it should be bacteria or microbial free, it should be treated with some chemicals or to make it like chlorine. You know that chlorine that is used to purify water to kill the germs. Okay, so for waterborne microbes we can prevent exposure by providing safe drinking water, the water which is free from microbes, or after that the water filter the water, and then the water can be boiled to kill the germs. Okay, and now you know there are many things for like you aqua guard and all, you know? So by using that also the germs can be killed. This can be done by treating the water to kill any microbial contamination. Okay, now for waterborne infections, vector borne infections, they are the some insect or some animal that carries the microbe. So in that case, how it can be prevented? By cleaning the surroundings clean, like mosquito, it causes malaria and dengue. So by that it should be clean, it should be dry. It should not provide the breeding grounds for the mosquitoes. Okay, this would not for, in other words, public hygiene is one basic key to prevent to the prevention of infectious disease. Understood or no? Now students, One another thing is important thing is this, that in the class if anyone suffers from cold, okay, some students may catch cold, some students may not catch cold. Why? Because the immune system of some students is stronger than the other students. Now what is immune system? You see here. Now you know what happens, immune system is generally it fights the microbe. If any foreign bacteria or any foreign microbe enters the body, the immune system is specialized to kill that microbe to protect the body. Okay, now there are certain cells that are specialized in killing the infectious microbe. So these cells, whenever the microbe enters, these cells go into action each time infecting microbe enters the body and kill the microbes. Understood? If they are successful in killing or damaging the microbe, okay, what happens? The person doesn't get disease. Okay, now immune cells manage to kill off the infections long before it assumes major proportions. As we noted earlier, what happens if the number of microbes are more and if the immune system is strong, then more cells can go and will kill all the microbes or damage all the microbes. What will happen? The severity of disease will be less, or a person may not get disease. But if the immune system is weak, the very less cells are will be produced and they will not be capable to kill all the microbes. So some microbes will remain in the body, and you know the microbes will multiply, and the disease, a person will get disease. So understood? And like, to remain healthy, we need a balanced diet. We eat a balanced diet. So for a strong immune system, we have to have a balanced diet, a nutritious food. Okay, the functioning of the immune system, like any other system in our body, can not be good if proper and sufficient nourishment and food is not available. Okay, so that is the, now these are general ways of preventing infectious disease. But student, there is one very important way of preventing some of the very very harmful or life threatening disease. Like, you know, before there was a smallpox. Okay, now these days there is no smallpox anywhere in the world, but as recently as 100 years ago, smallpox epidemics were not at all uncommon. It was a major problem. Okay, and it's very highly infectious disease. Now in such an epidemic, what happened? People were so much scared to go near the person infected with the smallpox because they may also get the disease, as it's highly infectious. Now there was some group of people who were safe, who did not have a fear of getting smallpox. Okay, so these people at that time, they took care of those people who suffered from smallpox, but they did not have any fear of getting the smallpox. So what does it mean? It means they were those people who already suffered from smallpox, and now their bodies protected. Okay, now they do not have the fear of getting smallpox, or that immunity, or kind of prevention from the recurring of the smallpox. Okay, now because if a person have a smallpox before, is already infected by smallpox or also chickenpox, then they get permanent immunity. Then again they do not get that disease. Understood or no? So what happens in that case? How it happens? This happens because, suppose if the smallpox microbe, it enters the body, okay, it's an infectious disease. Now our body responds against it, and response to that microbe of smallpox, our body produces certain antibodies. Okay, now these antibodies, they kill that microbe. Okay, now there is a specific antibody for each microbe. Like for smallpox microbe, there are some specific antibodies. For chickenpox, specific antibodies. Then even for now, this For like for different disease, there are different antibodies. So when the smallpox microbe enters the body, what happens? The antibodies in response to that microbe is produced. It remains in the body. Okay, and now again, and it remembers that microbe. Now again, when a person gets infected by that microbe of smallpox, let us say the already antibodies which is produced in the body, they fights with great vigor and kill the microbe, and the body is not infected by it. Okay, now so that is why a person gets a permanent prevention from that particular microbe. Now what is a vaccine? Now you know that in certain diseases which are harmful or which are life threatening, a vaccine is given. Like there's a smallpox vaccine, there's a polio vaccine. What is vaccine? Vaccine is nothing but it is a method to fool the immune system. Now in vaccine, what happens? A weakened a microbe or a dead microbe, because here what they do in a vaccine, they try to fool the immune system. They try to create antibodies of that particular microbe. Okay, like in a vaccine, a weakened or a dead microbe causing a particular disease is injected or is given inside the body. Now what will happen? Now this is a foreign microbe, though the microbe is dead, or it can be, or it's weakened, but the microbe is foreign, and when this microbe, this foreign microbe, or when this pathogen, you can say, it enters the body, what happens? The immune system responds. Now immune system doesn't know, immune system responds, it produces the antibodies against that microbe. Okay, and that antibodies remains in the body, and our body is not harmed because the microbe, that harmful microbe or a pathogen, is dead, or it is very very weak. It cannot cause any harm to the body. That dead microbe or the weakened microbe is entered in the body or is injected in the body, or just to produce the antibodies. Now once the antibodies are produced in the body, again when a healthy microbe infects the body, already the antibodies are produced and they fight with great vigor and they kill the foreign healthy microbe, and a person doesn't get a disease. So this is what, this is vaccine. Okay, so with this I finish this chapter. Students, please study all these things. Again I am saying that 13.3.3, that is not excluded, I have already explained. So this is included, everything is included from page number 183, 184, 185 and 186. Okay, thank you students. Have a nice day.